started a thankful jar?
My mom has.
Good deal. I have mine too. But let's focus on, Teresa said something today in our class as we were talking about being thankful. You know that you need to have an attitude of gratitude. And did you know that gratitude is a worship language? I thought that was kind of awesome. So I want us to worship the Lord today in all that's said and all that's done. Truly being thankful to Him. Because He has provided our every need. He's in control of all things. He will never leave us, never forsake us. He will never stop loving us. And one of these days, He's going to call us home to live forever and ever and ever. So I'm just so thankful for that. So let's worship Him this morning. Let's stand and sing forever. We're not singing forever. We're singing a song.
Thank you.
is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For by grace you have been saved through faith. Nothing that we did in and of ourselves, it is God's gift to us. So now let's sing, "Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul."
Surgery at 10:40, and I am confident everything's going to go fine. That's why I set up a tea time for 2 o'clock.
Sweet or unsweet tea?
No, I'm confident everything goes fine, but I need your prayers. I'll be about 2 weeks at the house, and they'll do physical therapy and occupational therapy there. And then I should be able to be back in church, but I don't know. I'll still be at full capacity, but they say 4 to 6 weeks. So about where I've ever been full capacity, so I'm going to see something. That'll be something new for me. So I'm looking forward to that. But no, I do appreciate your prayers. I appreciate everybody's done. Bill's still getting for me to any time there. What would he say? He's on tune time. He's on tune time. But I do appreciate that. Next week, you'll have a friend of mine, evangelist LaVon Innes. He is brother to Charles Innes, pastor, the one pastor at Fellowship Church in Clayton. He's a longtime friend of mine. I used to work with Paul B. Williams. He was my assistant service manager. And then he's out of Billy Cashwell's church, Benson Grove Baptist Church. LaVon and I, he's also our Sistel representative. He sells us our coffee. This way I get coffee at a cheaper price. So, no, I didn't say that earlier, okay? But so you'll enjoy LaVon. He's going to be here next week, and then Bill will be up back, and then he'll be back the week after that, and then hopefully I can be back. I may have to deal, sit down, but we'll. I'm looking forward. I don't want to be out of pulpit for too long now. Y'all might get used to it. But let's go to the Lord's word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the blessing. Thank you for the privilege we have to be in your house and to worship you this morning. Lord, I just pray that each and every person here would open their hearts, Lord. Yep. May the Holy Spirit fill them from the crown of their head to the sole of their feet. Lord, just let us be ready for what you have for us today. Lord, if there's one here or one listening by way of internet that does not know you as Savior, Father, then I just pray today that they would come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And I thank you, Lord, for watching that one who was baptized yesterday, who took a step of faith and was baptized and submitted to following you. Lord, I pray you bless all of them in a very special way. Lord, thank you for that. That's the greatest thing that we can ever see. Lord, I ask again that you have your will and way. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.
I made it through the fire.
But anyway, we had to go to the hospital last night, as you were saying, in the building. I'm not sure how Chelsea and Jeremy got into this. But when they come back home, Jeremy is asleep and Mark and Deborah's bed. And Chelsea says, I'll just go in there and sleep with him, and you can just sleep out here. And Mark said, the sick man with the thing on his chest that shows his head has to sleep on the couch in his own house.
You have children.
I just told them to go and sleep in my bed.
That's what we do as parents. We sacrifice so much. God bless you. That's all I was going to say.
All right. I mean, y'all glad to be at Tabernacle this morning. Yeah. Take your house lights up. Stand up and around this morning. You're glad to see them this morning.
Amen.
Thank you.
things over.
Material and special batting quilts for the batting is really expensive. So, Cindy and I had come up with an idea about selling calendars.
Candles are good.
Mark, where did she stop out there on the way home?
But we're selling calendars for the quilting ministry. They're $10 a piece. If anybody would like one, let me know. We're going to start giving them out on the first, but people want them now. So please come by me or Cindy, and we'll give you one. We'll get you one for $10, okay? All right, thank you so much.
I already bought one off, okay? So get it all the way out. That'll help the quilting ministry, which is going really well. People are really responding to that. All right, time to receive the children's offering. Let's have all the kids from 12 and under. All the kids 12 and under. That's right. Come on, I got to sit back up here today. See, I'll still have to go. If I don't, I'll get real jitters. Somebody grab the All right, as you hold up a dollar bill of five, whatever you hold up, please put a smile on your face. Let them see a happy giver. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to teach these children the precious blessing of giving back to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Prayers. Ushers. Come on, Mr. Ashley. Please bless the blessing for this offering, please.
Father, bless this offering, Lord. I pray that we would use it for your glory and your honor. And I pray that we would not be wasteful in the funds that you have provided.
Yes.
Father, I pray that you would bless the service today, Lord, and let us give our money, let us give money up our times, our talents, everything, Father.
Yes.
And let it be today that we start with this service and give it to you, give ourselves to you, and let us worship you in the way that you want us to worship you. We'll love you always in Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Though the sails are torn,
sails are torn. And I I've had visions.
y'all pray for her. She's going to be a caregiver for the next 4 to 6 weeks.
Woo! What? Going to be?
Did I not phrase that correctly? Oh, I'm getting in trouble with this part again. Before I get in trouble, turn your Bible to 1 Peter chapter 7. I want to continue.
You're already there.
I want to continue in our study of, I'm doing a two-part message on marriage. I did on, wives week before last. I'm going to do on husbands this week. Grace at Home, part two. But while you're turning, let me just say, I thank all those who came out yesterday morning for the community prayer time. We're having 3 churches participate. We've got some more coming, I think, especially when COVID ends. We had Mark Cottle from Pierce's and Steve Barron was here, and some of their members were here. We had about 12 people yesterday. It's growing. It's getting more and more every week. We've had a tremendous time in prayer. Now, we started out praying for this before the election. But we have decided after the election, we need to pray for this country on a regular basis, at least once a month. We're going to come together as churches and the community. All of us come together, different churches, at different locations, different times, and just pray. We don't have any preaching, don't have any singing, don't have any food. So don't come expecting to be a Baptist. All right? But we just meet and have prayer time for this country. Second Saturday in each month, we'll meet at the churches at 9 o'clock. Next month, we will meet at Steve Barron's church, New Hope Christian Church. Steve Barron, 9 o'clock. So put that on your calendar. Get you one of these calendars right here and write it down, okay? So that you'll know what day it is. I appreciate everybody coming out. We're going to try to continue this because our country needs... Listen, we're in a mess right now. And it just keeps getting worse. And this country needs prayer more than anything. That's the only thing we'll change, folks. It ain't going to come in Democrats. It ain't going to come in Republicans. It ain't going to come in Trump. It ain't going to come in Biden. It's going to come through the way of Jesus Christ. My Savior. We've got to have revival.
Yeah.
And the only way we're going to have it is when the church... Praise God, I may just change the message this morning. When the church gets right and starts coming together and gets earnest enough... Listen to me, I love you this morning. When you get earnest enough to turn off the TV, get up early on Sunday, Saturday morning, come together, get with the people in the community, and begin to pray and seek God's face, God will hear an answer from heaven. Say amen or
amen.
All right. Grace at Home, part two. I want you to understand that if we want God's grace to transform our marriages, and that's what we're talking about, then we've got to submit to husbands. Listen to me, we have to submit to our wives as well as wives submit to your husbands. You've got to understand them, you've got to value them so that they're in our prayers. And our prayers are not cut off. Did you know you hinder your prayers if you mistreat your wife? Hello? God does not hear your prayers if you mistreat your wife. I'm going to show you that this morning. We opened with Mr. Foster, who's a teacher in grade school in Auburn, Washington. And she had a frustrating day with her students. One in particular was just aggravating her. She said, you've been doing irritating things all day today. And these things, some of them are my pet peeves. Do you know what a pet peeve is? And the boy said, no, I'm not really. What is it? I don't know what it is. She said, a pet peeve is that person that irritates you the most. Do you know what my pet peeve is? He thought for a moment. He said, maybe Mr. Foster? So apparently his boy's dad was his mom's greatest pet peeve and gave him the hardest time. Now, that's true for relationships. It's true in our marriage. It's true in all of our relationships. We sometimes irritate one another. Say amen.
Amen.
You get irritated with your wife, get irritated with your husband, get irritated with your girlfriend, your boyfriend, your boss man, your employer. You get irritated with yourself sometimes.
Amen.
Okay, we get irritated. But God's grace is available during those times when we're irritated. Matter of fact, God's grace can transform any marriage. It can transform any relationship if you allow it to. Now, last time we looked, we saw the secret was to humble ourselves in a submissive spirit. And because when we demand our own way and insist our own rights in a relationship, there's going to be friction. If you want your way and she wants her way, somebody's going to have to give. There's going to be friction if you both demand that you get your own way. So it's a matter of, I said last time, I'm saying it again, it's a matter of mutual submission.
Yeah.
If you love your spouse, there is a mutual submission. When we submit to one another, then God's grace intervenes in a powerful, powerful way.
last week, as I said, we saw how grace, how a wife is supposed to submit to her husband. And today we're going to see how God's grace says husbands are supposed to submit to the wife. I want you to look at 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7. Stand, if you will, for reading God's word. I'm going to sit. By the way, while you're standing, let me just tell you this. I get used to sitting down. Except when I get excited and want to run. That's why they put this curtain up here. Last time I preached sitting down like this, they didn't have this curtain. And I couldn't get up and walk around, but they said my feet were just kicking under the table. And it didn't look good on the video, so they said, we'll cover that up. Am I right? That's exactly what they did. So if you see this curtain starting to move, it's where my feet kicking. Don't worry about it, okay? Word of God said, husbands, likewise, dwell with them with understanding, giving honor to the wife as to the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for what's been done here already, all the songs that have been sung, the fellowship. Lord, just the time of presence with your Holy Spirit. Lord, you have moved in a miraculous way. Lord, if we had to close the book and go home right now, we've had church today. But Lord, I thank you for the reading of your word, and I ask now that you open our hearts. Lord, as husbands, here today, this is something we really need to take to heart, and I don't think, Lord, that the men understand the implication of being submissive and following your wife and honoring your wife. Not in a subservient way, but in a way of honoring her. As she is to honor us, we also are to honor her. Lord, give me wisdom. Give me the ability to preach this message. Let me get out of the way. May the Holy Spirit speak through me. And touch hearts, Lord, of each and every marriage, each and every relationship that is here today. And if there's one that's lost, God, today, may the Holy Spirit speak to their hearts. Show them the need of salvation and bring them to that point today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 Thank you. You may be seated. Now, literally, excuse me a minute. And the original text says husbands in the same way. Husbands were they translated likewise in the New King James Version. The original text literally says in the same way, live with the wife according to knowledge. In other words, we men are commanded by God to live with our wives in the same way that our wives are to live with us. Now, I'm not a rocket scientist, but it don't take much to figure out. If wives are to submit to their husbands, and husbands are to live in the same way with their wives, you submit to your wife, you will. You follow, okay? Now, you're responsible for making ultimate decisions, I know that. And I said that last week. But you're also responsible to listen, to value, and to honor her guidance and her opinion. Amen. If you need to, you can use the elbows. Okay? There. Men and men, therefore, the wives, we're told to be submissive to their husbands, and so you win him or you woo him to the Lord. Well, if husbands are to live with their wives in the same way, then the first thing you have to do, listen to me, is submit. You've got to rank we have to rank ourselves as under our wives. We must put ourselves under the authority. I said last week, the Bible talks about a husband-wife relationship, and it's always in the context of a mutual submission. Not a one-sided submission, but a mutual submission. You see, when each one puts the others first in the relationship, then you have harmony in the home.
Yeah.
But when either one of you demands your way over the other one's way, you're not going to have harmony. You're going to have a fight.
Amen.
Amen.
All right? Guys, if you want God to permeate your home and transform your relationship, transform your marriage, then you got to learn to put your wife before yourself in a relationship. Make her agenda your agenda for the day. Did you hear what I said? Make her agenda your agenda for the day. Make her agenda more important than your agenda. I told the wives, though, make his agenda more important than your agenda. I'm telling you now, make her agenda more important than yours.
Yeah.
Put her first. Put her first. Put her interest above your own interest. Sometimes you know Philip Yancey. How many of you are familiar with Philip Yancey? Great Christian author. He and his wife reached their 25th anniversary, and I want to read a quote to you. He reflected on experience. I'm quoting from him there. He said, before marriage, each by instinct strives to be what the other wants. The young woman desires to look sexy and take up interest in sports. The young man knows his plants and flowers and works at asking questions instead of answering in monosyllables. After marriage, the process slows and somewhat reverses. Each insists on his or her rights, each resisting bending to the other's will. And I continue, after years, though, the process may suddenly begin to reverse again. Yancey wrote, I sense a new willingness to bend back toward the other than what the other wants, maturely this time. Not out of a desire to catch a mate, but out of a desire to please someone who has shared a quarter century of life. I grieve for those couples who give up before reaching this stage. You spent a quarter of a century of your life together. It's time to go back to putting each other first instead of yourself. Now, that goes against the flesh because we're selfish, especially after 25 years of trying to get what you want. Amen. So it goes against the flesh. Philip Yancey captured the essence, I think, of what God is telling us, both husbands and wives, to do. Stop, listen to me, stop insisting on your own rights and strive to be what the other wants. Bend towards one another's will. David Gatz is another Christian psychologist and writer. He wrote a marriage partnership. He said, this is his personal account now. And I think you men, if you put yourself in his place here, some of you are going to identify with this. Not in the same jobs that he had, but in how you tried to mold your will into getting your wife to do what you wanted to do. He said, I asked my wife, who supported me for years in different venues. Said, then when we were first married, I was a youth pastor and I was taking classes at the University of Colorado at Denver. He said, I was going to be a writer. So Jan and I moved to the Chicago suburbs so I could take a job as a writer and editor. Said, about 4 years later, I became restless. So I decided I'd work on an MBA. I expected her to sacrifice, and she did. By that time, we had one child, and I also had a book contract. So I was working full-time, going to graduate school two nights a week, and writing a book. I'm not the one sacrificing, she is. Then I decided to start my own business. By this time, we had two children. And the week I told her I was leaving my secure job to start a business, she told me she was pregnant again. And again, who sacrificed? So recently, he said, Janet told me she wants to go back to school. She wants to go back to school. And how did I respond? I became unsupportive and critical. I thought, we don't have the money. Or you actually need to work more because it didn't matter to me. We didn't have money for me to get my MBA and start my own business. He said, I had a great opportunity to give up power to sacrifice some of the things I wanted so I could help my wife with her dreams. But I told Gunner the other day, I know my head that I need to do this. And it's killing me because it's so difficult. Why? Because I think about what I have to give up and I want my goals. Don't we all? Men, we've been there. Our wives, many times have sacrificed so that we could fulfill our goals and our ambitions and our desires. And how much thought have we given to their goals, ambitions, and desires? It's going to get real in a minute. Okay? If it hasn't already, it's going to get real. We all have selfish heart. So in order to work, we need God's heart within us. We need to depend upon Christ, who made the ultimate sacrifice for us on the cross. Down with you, would please. If we're going to submit to our mates, we need to, listen, you can't submit to your mate and follow his or her wishes and desires until you first submit to Christ. You got to have Christ's heart. Then he'll give you not only the power, but also the desire to follow. He'll give us the power and desire to love our wives as Christ loved the church. Men, Christ gave himself for the church. Have you given yourself for your bride? In all that you have and in all that you do. Boy, it's quieter in here than it's been in a long time. And that's okay. Some sermons you got to shout and holler, amen, glory, hallelujah. Other ones you got to say, oh me and help me, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Huh? Good point. If you want to see God, men, if you want God to see transform your marriages, then you got to submit to your wives. You got to put their interest above your own interest. But in order to do that, listen to me. This is going to get really complicated. You have to first understand her.
Huh?
Did you hear what I said? You have to understand her. And I jokingly say many, many times, if you understand your wife, just wait a few minutes, she'll change. But the truth of the matter is, you have to work at understanding her. We have to comprehend her needs, fears, hopes, and moods. One translation, 1 Peter 3, says, husbands, in the same way, live with your wives according to knowledge. Now, Vine's Dictionary for New Testament words, talking about knowledge, is primarily an inquiry or an investigation. In other words, men, you got to study your wife. You have to study her. We have to go to school. And we need a doctorate level in understanding them. And sad to say, most of us don't even have a grade school understanding of them. Wives, you're being quiet.
You sure?
Yeah. The different grades.
I didn't say in school and I got to start now.
Yes, you got to start now. No, you should have already started. Warren Risby says, in my premarital counseling, and I've done this as a pastor as well, he said, I often give couples pads of paper and I ask them to write down three things each one thinks the other enjoys doing the most. And he says, usually the prospective bride makes her list immediately and the man would sit and ponder and think. Usually the girl was right, but the man was wrong. What a beginning for a marriage if you don't understand what she likes to do. She's going to, huh?
That's where we spend the rest of it. She's right or wrong. Usually I'm sorry, too.
Guys, let me ask you some questions. And I want you to answer them to yourself. Don't yell them out. I might yell out one or two because I know what my wife likes. But anyhow, do you know what your wife enjoys doing the most? Do you know her favorite color or her favorite thing to eat? That would be hamburgers. What does she like to do to relax? Christmas movie.
Oh.
What kind of flower does she appreciate the most? Plastic ones. Am I right? What's her favorite movie and why? Her favorite restaurant. Did you know these things about your wife? Can you answer them? I can assure you she knows these things about you. But if you don't know these things, go to school. Get you a pad and a piece of paper and sit down and ask her. She won't bother her. Because that way she'll next time you get her the wrong kind of perfume or the wrong kind of flower, say, you wrote it down. So don't lose your list. Amen? Sit down with her and ask her about these things, listen and take notes, and then put pleasing her at the top of her agenda. If she likes flowers, bring her a favorite flowers. If she likes a restaurant, take her to that restaurant. Watch her favorite movie with her. Now, my wife will tell you, I am not a Christmas movie fan. But I will watch every once in a while. We'll sit down and I'll watch it. Just because she loves it, I will watch a Christmas movie. And you know what? She will sit down and watch a football game with me. Amen. Huh?
Of course, it's football.
Yeah. But find out what you're, that's what I'm saying. It's not about something. I had to get this message ready. And so I began to look at things I was doing at the house. Yesterday was Saturday. Who knows what happens on television on Saturday? Football all day long. Well, I watched the Carolina football game. I watched Florida State and watched that one. And then State was coming on. They were going to play, and I kind of wanted to watch that one. And then there was a couple more coming on that I kind of wanted to watch. I looked at my wife, and I said, hey, you're in control. Why don't you get me out of Christmas movie? She sat there and watched two Christmas movies. I watched them a little bit, and then I read a book. But what I'm saying to you is, I have my time. I need to give her some time. Guys, that's what I'm talking about. Just try to be conscientious enough to look at what's going on around in your house and in your home with your wife and put your wife's interest first.
It's just easier to buy a second TV.
Huh?
It's just easier to buy a second TV.
Yeah, but I'm glad you mentioned that.
I know where this is going.
The worst thing you can do, I believe, just put a TV in your bedroom.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Don't throw tomatoes yet. Right? I think it does more to disrupt family unity. Because, number one, cut the TV off when you go to the bedroom. Snuggle, okay? Snuggle. Spend time with each other. And for you to sit in one room watching TV and her sit in another room watching TV, what kind of unity is that?
Yep.
Go ahead. Thank you. Yep. I appreciate that. Good to see you, buddy.
Hey, you too, man.
Good to see you. You snuck in.
He's right on time.
Yeah, he's right on time. Yeah. Listen. Watch your favorite movie with you. Do some of her favorite things together. That's what living with your wife according to knowledge means. Let's treat her as the weaker partner. It's an unfortunate translation, but the NIV says, treat her as the weaker partner. Now, I want to tell you something. She's not, that door won't stay shut.
I know it did.
I know you did. It's the Holy Spirit coming in. Ugly back. He's already here. Come on, he's already here. Listen, women are not weaker partners. They're not even weaker vessels. Listen, they're not weaker mentally, morally, or spiritually. Most women may be weaker physically, but let me tell you something. I believe with all my heart, they're stronger morally and spiritually than most men are.
Yep.
And that hurts to say, but I believe that with all my heart. Now, the literal translation lives with her as a weaker vessel. I'm sorry, that's the correct translation. It means as a delicate, fragile vase. Now, I was going to bring them with me, but I didn't this morning. But if I had a 25-cent plastic coffee mug up here, matter of fact, this plastic cup, I can take that thing and I can throw it on the ground and throw it on the pulpit and it won't break. And it ain't 25 cents. But if I had one of your delicate China teacups, I wouldn't dare throw that thing on the ground. Because it'd break. Why? Because it's fragile. It's the weaker of the two vessels. I can't bang it around and beat it and all that kind of stuff. I can't be rough with it, and I certainly can't drop it without doing serious damage to it. Well, that's what it means. Your wife is fragile. She's the weaker vessel in that you have to treat her differently than you. I mean, men can be rough with one another. Men get together and say, hey, man, you put on a few pounds there, didn't you? You say, yeah, I did. You say that to your wife, you might miss a few teeth. Say amen.
Then we're not the weaker vessel.
Why? She doesn't respond to saying, it ain't no big deal to you if you put on a few pounds. A big deal, but it is to them, and you better not say it. Why? Because she's fragile. You'll hurt her ego. You'll hurt her relationship. Gordon McDonald shares a moving story about Dr. Paul Reese and Elizabeth Reese. They were in their 60s, when they were in their 90s. They've been married for 60 years, 60 plus years. And McDonald asked him, he said, y'all still fight after 60 years of marriage? He said, we sure do. Yesterday morning was a case in point. Edith and I were in our car and she was driving and she failed to stop at a stop sign and it scared me to half to death. Gordon McDonald said, well, what did you do? He said, well, I've loved Edith for all these years and I know I've learned how to say hard things to her. But I was careful because when Edith was a young girl, her father used to scold her harshly. And he spoke to her in ways that even today she hears a manly voice speak in anger. Even my voice, it hurts deeply. McDonald said, Paul, what did you do? Edith, 90 years old, you tell me she remembers that harsh. She said, he said, she remembers it now more than ever. He said, how did you handle the driving situation? He said, well, I simply said, Edith, darling, after we've had our afternoon nap, I want to discuss a thought I have for you. He said, when the nap was over, I was calm, she was ready to listen, and we solved our problem. And I'm quoting McDonald now. He said, these are a word of a man who has learned that conflict is necessary, can be productive, but must be managed with wisdom and grace.
Yep.
By the time I reach 90, I hope I'm just like him. Dr. Reese had gone to school with his wife. He had studied her. He had a PhD in understanding her. And with God's help, we got to do the same thing. Now, with that in mind, I want to close with this thought. Husbands, value your wives. You must value them. You've got to honor them. You've got to respect them as equal heirs. 1 Peter 3:7 says, giving honor to the wife. That means treat them with respect. Listen to what they're saying.
You mean listen to what they're saying?
I mean listen to what they're saying.
Grant them honor aside their values as heirs with the gracious gift. That's what the Bible says in Ephesians 3:6. The Gentiles should be fellow heirs of the same body and partakers of this promise of Christ through the gospel. That means Gentiles are heirs together with Israel. Using the same terminology here, that means Jews and Gentiles are equal heirs with God. That means husbands and men and women are equal heirs of God's grace. God values women just as much as he does men. He asks men to value their women in the same way. You're supposed to value that woman just like God valued her. I read a story in February, this is a long time ago, 1988. But I never forgot it. I went back and looked it up online. Went back, it's about a man in an island in the South Pacific. It's a true story. His name was Johnny Lingo. Now remember, this is an island in the South Pacific. They don't do things like we do. This is not our culture. So don't get upset at what I'm about to tell you. This was their culture, this is accepted value, and this is what they do. Now, he was the strongest, richest, and brightest young man around, and he was the sharpest trader. That's why no one could figure out why he paid so much for his wife. According to the island custom, two or three cows might be a fair price to pay for a wife. If she was a good wife, that'd be a fair price. Five cows would fetch a highly satisfactory wife. But to pay eight cows for a wife, she'd have to be Miss Universe. Well, Johnny's wife, Serena, was anything but beautiful in the eyes of the islanders. Before she married Johnny, she was a scrawny, homely-looking girl, walked with her shoulders over and her head ducked down. She was afraid of her own shadow. And her father would have felt lucky to get one cow for her. But Johnny came to her father and said, "Father, Serena, I offer eight cows for your daughter." Now, that was an unbelievable story. And that's what the islanders told us. Reporter Patricia that went to hear her talk about it. And when she did, she said, "I've got to find this most beautiful woman I've ever seen." She found her, and she said, "I did find the most beautiful woman I had ever seen on this island." She told Johnny what the islanders had said about his wife, and he just smiled. Then he told her this story. He said, "Do you ever think what it must mean to a woman to know that her husband has settled on the lowest price for which she can be bought?" And then later, when the women talk, they boast of what their husbands paid for them. One says, "Four cows, another maybe six. How do you feel, the woman who was sold for one or two cows? This could have been not happened to my Serena." "Many things can change a woman," he said. "Things happen inside, things happen outside. But the thing that matters the most is what she thinks about herself. In Quinita, Serena believed she was worth nothing. Now she knows she's worth it more than any other woman on this island." Johnny said, "I wanted to marry Serena. I love her and no other woman. But I wanted an eight cow wife. And that's what I got." She's highly bad. Guys, let me ask you this. Now that's a true story. I mean that's the custom in that island. That's a true story. But let me ask you this. Does your wife know does she know that you value her more than any other woman on the face of this earth? How did you communicate that to her this week? Here's an assignment for you. Listen to me. Women, write this down. Make sure they get it. Ask your wife what makes her feel the most valued by you. What makes her feel the most valued by you? And when she tells it, put it on your agenda and do it as often as you can for her. Now, I'm not trying to pat myself on the back, because Lord knows I have failed many, 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 many times to put my wife's certain interest for me. But I've had men to criticize me sometimes, because when Joy's at home now, she's not working. Well, she's working at home. That's full-time, too. But I'm talking about when she was working a public job. Black Social Media County. How many years were you there? 25 years. It got to the point where she was working so much till I did most of the household chores. I would wash the clothes. I would cook supper. I would do the things that she didn't have time to do because she was working. You know why? Because I loved her. Because I wanted her to have, when she got home, I wanted her, she'd been working, so I wanted her to have some time to relax a little bit. And I'd try to fix the supper and I'd come in and eat and go sit down and relax.
I didn't stumble on that accident. God laid that on my heart. I was in a position where I could work here at the church, go home, put on a little clothes, never wash, work on the computer while I was there, while they were doing that. I could do that and never miss a lick of work. She couldn't do that. Husbands, cherish your wives. Amen. Any burden that you can take off of her, any way that you can help her, that is a value to her. Women, help me out. Is that right? Amen. If they take a burden off you, is that not valuable to you?
Amen.
Then do it. Now then, do it. Guys, if you truly love your wife, then you got to grant her value. You got to assign her honor every day, and God can then transform your marriage. And I'll close with this, and this is really a key point. So that your prayers keep from being cut off. That keeps you in communication with God. Keeps a channel of blessing open between God and the family. This is what verse 7 says. Husbands, likewise, dwell with them with understanding, giving honor to the wife as to the weaker vessel, and being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered. You ever prayed and felt like God didn't hear it? Ask yourself, how did I treat my wife this morning? How did I treat my wife today? Did I snap at her? Now, we're human beings. Husbands and wives both are going to lose the control every once in a while, and you're going to see things, say things that you don't mean. Okay? Now granted, say amen.
Amen. Amen.
But the point of it is, don't let it dwell. As soon as you recognize that, stop and say, I'm sorry. Forgive me.
Amen.
I didn't mean to speak out of turn. Goes a long way, doesn't it, ladies? Well, y'all ain't helping me out much this morning. I'm going to have to preach that message on men for men again, I think. But anyhow, men, if you don't treat your wives and girlfriends and things with understanding and respect, then God will not listen to your prayers. They'll be cut off and they'll never reach heaven. That's because there is a direct correlation between our relationship with God and our relationship with our spouse. Have I not told you that the marriage is an earthly representation of our heavenly relationship with God?
Amen.
If you don't treat God with respect and honor and love Him and pray to Him, you ain't going to hear from Him. Relationship's broken. Treat your wife in the same way. That relationship still works. I hope y'all can really begin to see the parallel now between the heavenly relationship and the earthly relationship of marriage. It's almost the same. It is a very deliberate comparison in the same way. So with that said, one greatly affects the other. If you want God to provide grace to transform your marriage, then you've got to submit to your wives, you got to understand them, and you got to value them so the prayer won't be cut off. Happy is the home where God is there. Love fills everyone. When we're united in work and prayer, the Master's will is done. That's a form of saying by Henry Ware. And it's very, very true. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. No one's looking around. This concludes that two-part series on marriage. And I hope it's been a blessing to you. But I would not be doing right if I didn't ask you this in closing. The first thing you have to do is you have to make sure that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. You have to make sure He lives in your heart. You can never treat your husband or your wife as you should if you don't first love the Lord. That's imperative. How many of you can say, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt, Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior today? As a word of testimony, would you lift up your hand? I'm saved and I know it. Thank you. God bless you. Lift it up high. God said, be ready to give an account. Acknowledge me before men, I'll acknowledge you before the Father. Deny me before men, I'll deny you before the Father. If you could not raise your hand, thank you, you may put them down. If you could not raise your hand, you say, preacher, pray for me. I'm not sure of my salvation today. I'll not come to you, not embarrass you in any way. Wouldn't do that, but I do want to have a closing prayer with you. Would you just say, preacher, pray for me? Slip up your hand, put it right down. Right back down. Eyes are closed, heads are bowed. I just want to have a word of prayer with you. Anyone at all? I'm not sure, preacher. Christian. Truth of the matter is, we all need stronger homes. We all need stronger families. We all need stronger marriages. So I'm asking you today, especially the men, but the women as well, respond to God's call. Just come to this altar this morning and say, Lord, help me to really learn to value my spouse, to understand them, and to mutually submit to them as I should, according to your word. Not according to my thought process, but according to your precious holy word. Would you stand to your feet, please, Heavenly Father? I pray you have your will and way in this invitation. I pray, God, husbands, wives, everybody in this congregation, even those, Lord, that are dating, Lord, they would come down and begin to prepare for that marriage that you're going to give them. Lord, help us to learn to mutually submit to one another. It's not a matter of my priority or your priority. It's the other way around. Honey, what can I do to help you? What would you like for me to do as your wife? God, help us this morning to come on humble knee. And God, transform our marriages and transform our homes, because that will transform your church. Have your will and way. May your children be obedient to your spirit. In Jesus' name I pray. As they begin to play, God spoke to your heart. You want that marriage transformed?